You've been listening to some Chicago footwork, and that is because we have one of the heroes and pioneers of Chicago footwork sitting next to me. This is Kavain Space, better known to some of you as RP Boo, yes. Rep in Tech Life. How you doing today?
Well, I'm fine. I'm glad to be here and to see you all and to be able to talk and give you a little bit of history about myself as well as the music and where it's about to go.
Indeed, we have a lot to talk about and show today about the roots of footwork, but let's start with your roots. Where are you from in Chicago? Give us a little, set the scene for us a little bit about where you grew up and what it was like in your household.
Well, I'm an older cat. A lot of people thought I started young, but I started in my 20s producing. But my childhood days, I'm born and raised on the west side of Chicago, 3224 West Fulton, within that area. A lot of good times coming up. I moved to the south side in the late 80s. So I was born to be, like they say, you that west side kid. Life was good. Listen to music, listen to the radio, listen to gospel music. Had a lot of singers in the household. Moms go to church, sing gospel music. My father was a bass guitar player. He moved to Boston in like 1977, around that time. Other than that, kids, we go run down the street, throw rocks at the bus. Roll tires down the street, take the big wheels, take the wheels off of create little miniature go-karts. School was fine. Other than that, I used to always have this dream and see these commercials, and I see like these old funk bands. And one day I saw, I think it was like Earth, Wind, and Fire on this commercial, the bell-bottom pants and the trumpet players in the background. And I just looked and I said, one day I want that to be me. I wanted to be a person that always played like the lead guitar, the bass, but that didn't happen. Other things took place. And in the days to come, only time will tell, but I didn't know what was going to happen. So, hey, the 80s was good. Now I'm on the south side of Chicago permanently, far south to where very well respected. I could walk anywhere in the city I want to walk.
Let me ask you something, because a lot of people in tracks and stuff talk about the south side of Chicago. What is the significance of that compared to the west side or the east side? Were there a lot of DJs and producers living in the south side, or was that where things were going on? What
south side is flooded with DJs and producers. I didn't know nothing about them until I moved to the south side. I only knew a couple of people that was out west, but it had a bigger scene because that's where a lot of Chicago house surfaced and went to the south side of Chicago. You got like Terry Hunter, Emmanuel Pippen, Little Louis now was out there. Then you had Frankie Knuckles would go out there every now and then, but a lot of the people that was out south was more househead than anything. And that's where a lot of these DJs was coming in from, Mike Dunn. Man, the list goes on and on. And like the majority, and still right now today, a lot of the big parties of house parties are done on the south side of Chicago. Still like that today.
So you weren't really allowed to go to parties for a while, right?
Nah.
How old were you when you went to your first like club night or party? Tell the truth.
I was in my 20s. Actually, I was in my 20s. I didn't do nothing in high school. I was just this kid that go to school, get good grades, come home. All the other kids would go out and party and have a nice time. And I was just more focused on getting a high school graduate, being a high school graduate and getting my diploma. I think the first big party I went to before I started going to club, and that's when I met House-O-Matics. And when I walked into this party, I was just introduced to the sounds of Dion and Milton, and the subs was hitting so hard, but when the kids walked past me, they just go find this circle and it just started dancing. And I was just hooked right then and there. I was like, what is this I just walked into? It was just something I'd never seen before, and I never heard anybody talk about it, but I saw it firsthand and I just fell in love.
Man, we'll get to House-O-Matics in just a quick second. But before that, I just want to say, you were listening to the radio, right?
Yes.
So that was your introduction to house music.
Radio was the introduction to house music. Yes, it was.
What were you listening to?
Oh, I was listening to WBMX, the Hot Mix 5. One of the main people that was on there was, his name was Keith Farley, but they called him Farley Jackmaster Funk. Farley Jackmaster Funk was just brilliant on those turntables. That dude, once he get on, I don't care who was on before him. When they hear Farley play, everybody bring out their tapes and press record. I don't care if the radio station was talking along it. That dude played tracks and stuff that he made. He played like Detroit house music, but his mixing skills and his scratching skill was just out of this world. I'm talking about jazz. I wouldn't record nobody else but Farley. And the way he played was just like bananas. But that was the radio. But what made me go into it another way, I went to a party my cousins used to have, and it was these two brothers named Chris and John. And they'd come out with the music same as Farley would play it, but the way they played it was just like grimy. I was like, these dudes sound better than the radio. I said, nah, I gotta do it.
Hopefully this works. I think I have a sample of Farley Jackmaster Funk from 102.7 WBMX. If this works, this is from 1987, so I guess you would have been about 15.
Yes, those was the days.
I wanted to play that because some of the way that the how loopy it is and how the samples are going, especially in that particular part, really reminds me of what later happens in Footwork.
Yes, that's a key role. And a lot of people didn't know that my style was created off of that. And that's why you have the way I set my breakdowns to where my chemistry when I make my tracks, when I first started, if you started playing any other person's track, with the breakdown and it blends, it just create that chemistry. But it was from those days. And a lot of people like, how did you do that? I listened to the radio. I studied. I learned and put it in my music, and it just came out phenomenal. It worked for me. It could work for anybody else, but they wanted to go somewhere else. Hey, I stuck with the chemistry and I left it that way.
Amen. So that's 1987, but when you're talking about House-O-Matics and DJ Dion and Milton, that gets to be a little bit later. So what year was it that you went to your first party?
1992. I had graduated from high school in 1991, so 1992, I was like, let me do something. Now I don't have to stay in the house. Moms was like, hey, you're out of high school now. What are you going to do? You got a job. Go out. Do some things. Oh, I can? Okay, I'm gone. I'm outside. But I was able to manage that, go to work, party, and enjoy buying new equipment, turntables. And it just started. And when I met House-O-Matic, the day I went to go trial for them, was the day of the beginning to where I'm at right now.
Okay, so what is House-O-Matics?
House-O-Matic was a dance troupe of teenagers south side of Chicago that wanted to do something different with the teenagers. A couple of guys, well, the president's name is Ronnie Sloan, and he have two brothers, David and Dave, and they danced a lot. Ronnie danced as well. and he went to Gage Park High School. So a couple of guys that I knew that lived in the neighborhood used to dance for them. And when they danced, it was like they get about four or five guys, a couple of girls, and they come on the streets and they go find people that they knew how to dance and battle them on the streets. And it was fun. But it was something to where once the people in the neighborhoods and other places started seeing them, they started coming in, and House-O-Matic decided one day, hey, let's throw some parties. When they started doing their parties, that's when they linked up with Deion and Milton. And their first party that they did it for, I think, two nights in a row, and they packed it. I'm talking about if the fire marshal would have came, they would have shut it down. They packed it, and from that day on, it was just history for them. They go to different places in Chicago, south side of Chicago, find like storefront joints or halls and talk to the owner and do parties. But the word got around town so fast to the point that what all you had to do was mention House-O-Matic and people was there. So I had to get curious. I'm like, I need to go find these dudes. And I found them. And man, this good times with them. Good times with them. Built a nice bond with them, too.
So you originally were trying out to be a dancer.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
That wasn't you weren't intending to be the DJ. You were trying out to dance.
It was just more dancing because when I first actually seen them dance and perform at a college, community college called Kennedy King College. And we did this. I was dancing with this group called Mega Move. So we get ready to go on stage. So the president of Mega Move, like, we're not gonna dance today. We're like, why? So this one guy came out and said, that routine you guys do, that's House-O-Matic's routine. So we was like, what? How is it that we get House-O-Matic's routine? Because one of the guys that's to come show us, he was a member of House-O-Matic's. And so the guy said, well, we still gonna do the routine. And House-O-Matic was in there. But when I saw House-O-Matic do this routine, you know how you go to this concert and the favorite person comes on and the kids just start screaming? When House-O-Matic did the first four moves, I jumped up and started screaming. I'm talking about, what the is this? Every move that we did, I saw it differently when they did it. Percolators, the way we did percolators, it was cool to the people on the street, but they changed it. But you could still see it. I'm like, oh my God, I gotta get in this group. And the track that they was dancing to, it was one of Deion tracks. And that just fit, it was just something totally different. It was the dance, it was on point. The track was on point. It was nothing like ever seen before. And man, House-O-Matic kept that reign from the day they started. I don't know what year they started, but in 1998, situation took part to where the group had dismembered for a while. But up to 1998, no dance group in Chicago could even touch them.
Okay, so now we're getting into the part of ghetto house and dance mania and Chicago house kind of speeding up, because I guess that must have been what House-O-Matic's was dancing to. So maybe let's hear just a little bit of this guy, DJ Deion, that you're talking about, and possibly some other quick ghetto house classics.
Take it. All right. Oh, man, you made me just... You just made me think about when I was on the turntables playing that.
Okay, so you try out to be a dancer, and then the guy running House-O-Matic's said, do you want to be a dancer, or are you going to be the DJ?
Yes, it was, I say, when I first started, after we got into the dancing, where we used to go get our mixtapes done, I used to do a couple of them for the group. They worked out pretty fine. But then doing these parties for House-O-Matic, it was like I was the main DJ, even if they brought in Deion and Milton. Deion and Milton might close out, but I open it up. But it was like to the point, Ronnie was like, hey, okay, what you want to do? I see you love to do your music, just spin the records or dance. He said, because we need you to be in one place and just focus on that. And he was like, what do you want to do? Do you want to dance, or do you just want to make the tracks and be the DJ? That was an easy question for me. I was like, I'm not going to sit back and keep dancing. I'm going to the music. That was simple. Hey, thanks for the ultimatum, but hey, I'm going. This music is where it's at. I bought this equipment, and I ain't finna stop spending no equipment for to stop spending no records for nobody. Hey, this is what I want to do, so I took the opportunity and I ran. I'm still getting down now.
You do. Maybe we'll see some of it tonight. Oh when
yeah.
You play.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
You and Tay can have a footwork battle.
Hey, we'll get out.
I know, I've seen it. The reason that I think this is so interesting, though, is because you started off DJing for a dance crew and making tapes for a dance crew. And that's a really important foundation, I think, of the footwork sound, is that it was something created for the dancers to dance to, and a conversation between you guys as the artist, as the producers and DJs, and the people who are on the floor doing the moves. Which is not necessarily true of all forms of electronic music.
Nah, it was the meat of that is basically when we was doing the mixtapes, it was more of the dance group presidents asking us to put a tape together and still include like radio songs, even if it was like Madonna, some Prince, or Jagged Edge, the slow dance routines. And they'd be like, well, we know you got some tracks here around here somewhere. Throw some tracks in. Okay, that's an opportunity, as the tracks I was making over the years could be put into this mix. But what happened, they changed it into the more dynamic of the footwork scene. It's more of after the performances was over. And if they have like an after party, there wasn't no more 5, 6, 7, 8s. Let's do this routine. No more. It was, let's do this. All night long for 6 hours. Let's do this. So we planned the ghetto house, planned the booty house, and we were still able to see these kids pull out these footwork moves all night long. They might do a couple of like body moves, whips, but they just focused on the floor. And with that being said, after I started and the other DJs started doing it as well, like when Rashad came in, we actually was feeding off these people and feed with them. So we had the opportunity to experiment our music with them. And as the week goes, the months goes, it was more of, man, that track is hot. That track is hot. Come on, man. We want some more. And when they thought that they were settled with that track, we throw another one on them. And it got to the point to where when I walked through the party, even though I always had a 9-to-5, I could come in and play 6 or 7 new tracks. And when I start off, I would play the new track right then and there. And the kids like, why are you steady doing this to us? Hey, I like to see you move. And they just wanted more, so everybody just got addicted to it. And like a lot of other DJs will say, you see what you just started, man. These kids out here, they don't want to hear nothing else. They just want to hear this fast stuff. And what is it? Hey, we didn't have a name for it. We just played. We just played from the heart. And we love to see them do their thing. And as they danced, it made us do more. And that was just our gift back to them. So they was gifted to us. We was gifted to them.
Before we move on a little bit to the birth of footwork, I want to show a video that it's from the House-O-Matics reunion in 2010. And you're going to see Dion at the beginning, this man you talked about, one of the pioneers of Ghetto House, talking. And also some different generations of dancers. So can we show it? Uh, I've seen talk to the hand before, but I've never seen talk to the shoe.
Right.
I wanted to show that video because you've been talking about House-O-Matics, but also in the beginning, you see kind of like the older Chicago house style of dancing. And then when that kid comes up in the striped shirt, you're getting more into like the footwork, younger, next generation style.
Yes, yes. And that's the birth of it. That's just how it started. That small footage was just it. The only difference, that was 2010. If it was 1996, 1997, the people in the background would have been jazzing as well. So that was just more of a, we haven't seen it in a long time. We're getting old. We can't do this. So those who was able to still do it, they just did it.
Well, respect. There was some people in that circle that were not young. That's for sure. So you're DJing these House-O-Matic events. At what point do you decide to buy some equipment and make your own tracks?
Well, I actually started buying equipment in 1991, as soon as I got out of high school. But the decision to make tracks, it was, it really wasn't on my mind because I had the gift to play the music. Just, I don't care who was back in the days. Even if it was Jammager, DJ Funk, whatever. If I had all their records, I could play it just as good as them, if not even better. But it was just about how I blend and make my sets. But one day, after I had met DJ Sluggo, it was more of, hey, we need a new CD, a new mixtape made. So they said, we're going to get Sluggo to make the tape. Go over to Sluggo's house, and I see this drum machine. So this one young lady says, how you make your tracks? So he pulled out the R70. He had this small, I think, Gemini mixer sampler. He had like three buttons on it. And he explained how he was making the tracks. So he actually demonstrated. So I'm like, that's cool. Look like it's kind of easy. So a couple of weeks later, I was like, where did you get the drum machine from? He was like, go to the Guitar Center. He said like about $500 or $600. So I said, okay. Got my paycheck on a Friday. Went to the Guitar Center that Saturday. And when it picked up the R70 and came with no instruction manual, no book. It was the last one. So the guy says, we don't have any more coming in that we know of, but we will sell you the display bottle. Do you want that? Yeah, I'm here. The only thing I got was they wiped it off and gave me my power pack and sent me home. And I was just so glad to have it. And that's when I just started making my tracks. That was like late 1995. And I had some problems with it because I didn't know what to do. I seen the press record. I hit it click, click, click. I didn't know how to extend the bars. I didn't know how to do nothing. It was just set on one bar. And I just started from that. And the rest is like history. I wasn't using samples at the time. Then I had bought my sampler from DJ Dion. The same sampler that he played, made some of his biggest hits off of. And I just went to work, and the tracks I started making some attention. So I was like, man, I'm getting the hang of this. And the people, even Sluggo was like, man, you got some nice tracks. And I was like, did I really think that I would make it this far in this less amount of time to be to the point to where people said, you got nice tracks? I'm like, I don't know what it is, but hey, why stop?
So you're talking about the Roland R70 is the machine that you had. And a lot of this sound of ghetto house and even footwork comes from not having a whole lot of sampling time, right?
Not a sample time. That's why you had to make it. What you could do, as long as it's a funky beat or a nice dance tune, that's what counts. That's the groove. The sample is something that people might use to, like they say, it's a cosmetic background. it'll spice it up a little bit. But before I really got into it, the west side of Chicago was known for what they call beat tracks. And no samples. It was just crazy, funky drum patterns and hi-hats, snares. But it's rhythmatic. And it was just, people just drive to it, just like feeling in their body and just go to work. So that played a big part too. So the west side was more beat tracks. South side was more samples.
So let's hear one of your early tracks, and then we can come back on.
Oh, let me see what we can find here.
Yeah, go for it.
Let me see.
You don't want to play Try to Break?
Let's go to Try to Break, yes. You can play it.
I got it.
All righty.
Just put that volume up there.
It's stuff like that drives me crazy. It's being able to hear voices, a nice melody voice, a nice pitch, but if you could just slow it down, just listen. You could do it to any song. If that song has so much power in it, slow it down and you'll find it. And I could take that track in certain parts and with the remixes I have done and just throw it on a slower pitch and just let it sit. And I could just hear things in there, and that's what drives me to do more for any track.
Is that how you usually start off making tracks, is with the sample that makes you feel something?
Oh, I used to. Now it's just anything. It's just, I could just be walking down the street and hear something. Especially if it's in like songs that have a message, or I'd be like, hey, how did somebody miss that? And it already didn't used it. And I'd be like, y'all don't listen. You have to just listen. Never close your ears to anything. You'll be surprised at what you could do. And just even hearing somebody's conversation, you could just do a nice track.
Yeah, you've made a lot of tracks that are inspired by everyday life, like things that people might take for granted.
Yeah.
Like the ice cream truck. What happened with the ice cream truck?
I got that idea from watching Eddie Murphy. and once I said I couldn't do nothing but laugh, I said, you know what, I'm going to make a track off the ice cream truck. And not knowing that this the same time where Master P did his. So that's why I actually got that sample from off the Master P ice cream truck. And once I found out it was just that open space, I was like, oh, yeah, I got you now. And I was like, let me try something different. And it happened, and people just fell in love instantly to that. So, hey, that was just the beginning of my days.
And you had a little girl who was your neighbor that you asked
Brianna.
To do some vocals.
Yeah, and as I told her what to say, and same thing like Eddie Murphy say, I got some ice cream and you can't have none. I just wanted to see a kid do it, and it worked.
That's cool. I love how you're just incorporating elements of everyday life.
Yeah.
It's not like you have to go find an orchestra sample or some really highfalutin thing every time.
Well, Baby Come On was one of the tracks that I really wanted somebody to be on it, as a young lady to be on it. But everybody asked, I don't want to be on it. I don't want to do no track. So I just left it as is, and it became a hit, with or without.
I want to ask you about this other track called Pop Machine.
Oh, yeah.
So where were you working at the time you made Pop Machine?
I was working at a quick lube called Speedway Oil Change. I think I was there well over like 8 years when I made the track. And how I came up with the concept, right outside the door of one of the bays, we always had a pop machine sitting there. And for years, we went through a Pepsi and a Coca-Cola machine. But it's like, for some reason, just this one day, this guy goes to the pop machine and he puts his money in it. And he was like, hey, man, what's wrong with this doggone pop machine? we were like, it took your money, right? You're like, yeah. Like, yeah, did it have a gun to you? Did it rob you? Like, you got jokes. I'm like, nah. Say, that pop machine, we forgot to put a sign up there to let people know that it's not working. So I walked up to him. I'm like, man, you probably had to walk up to it and just keep pressing the button. Like, work, 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 work. And it just hit me. I'm like, you know what? I'm going home. And I'm gonna make this, I'm gonna make a track called Pop Machine. I told my guy, I say, Marlon, I'm going home. I said, I'm gonna make a track called Pop Machine. Wait till you hear. The next day I played it to him, like, man, you a genius. He like, you is a genius. And a lot of people love the track. I never put it out. I'm looking to put it out real soon, but it worked. This track just worked. I know you got it queued up.
I do. So what did the oil guys at the oil change place that you were working at think about the fact that you were DJing and making footwork?
Oh, they was very supportive. If I was doing like big CDs, couple of they'd buy it. They would buy it. But they was like, this is just your gift. They work 10 hours a day, go home, make tracks, go to sleep, come back the next day, another 10 hours. So I was comfortable with what I was doing. It was just working and seeing the public come in. I had great ideas to make tracks. Just watching people come through. I made like a good 8 or 9 different tracks just watching people come through and the surroundings of this place. So Pop Machine was just one of them.
Well, let's hear it. Pop Machine. Pop Machine.
Yeah, I just had to put the part about with the girls because girls like to pop. So, hey, I say it'll work for them.
Do you always have this much fun making your tracks or do you ever agonize over them?
I have a lot of fun, especially back in those days. I used to catch myself making tracks and actually dancing while I'm making these tracks. So as I'm dancing, I used to get a little bit out of hand and forget I was, I need to finish this track.
You were dancing at work too, right?
Oh my God. Oh man, I was known on 59th and Western. I was known for... That dude is always dancing. I used to wait till the public the CTA, which is the our transit authority bus, come. As soon as it stops at the stop at the stoplight, and the door open, I just start dancing. Like, what's wrong with this dude? Even the owner of the job, like, somebody go get Kevin. He's always outside dancing. Come on in here, work on the cars. Come on. But I always did it on my downtime, and same as like with the CD cover, dude off 59th Street with the mask. I used to go outside with that mask on and just stand there and just dance. They had like this James Brown doll that you press the button and he started dancing and he played I Feel Good. I used to take it and sit on the bus stop bench. And as soon as the people get off the bus, I press the button. And, oh, I feel good. I'll be dancing with it. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Did this for years. For years. I was just always a happy person.
You're lucky. Not everybody is that happy all the time. Well, I want to ask you about another track that has a less happy story, which is this track that Sluggo put out, but it was actually yours.
Yeah, we could talk about it.
Okay, well, first of all, this track... what's the name? Wait, it's 114799.
114799.
Why was it called that?
114799. It was well, to get the story going, I was in this record pool, and Pharoah Munch came out with Simon Says. So I go to the record pool, and the guy normally has the record set out, and he'll be playing the tunes. So he was actually playing it. I was like, wait a minute. That got Godzilla in it. And I was like, do we get this record this month? He was like, yeah. So as we was packing up, two more other DJs from Chicago, and one of them had radio clout. He was a radio DJ. And the other guy was more of a track maker as well. So I was like, I got to beat him to the punch. I get home, and I was like, it's a instrumental. I said, please let this have this instrumental part, just direct, just the Godzilla music by itself. And that it did. So when I played it, after I made it, it was still, it still had no name when I made it. But when I made it, it was where I was at when I played it. The 11 stands for the 11th month, with this November. 47th is a party spot where we used to play some of our biggest tracks and just bang them. And 99 is the year. So 11, 47, 99. That's the name I gave it, and it stuck with it. And, man, that track just changed, just totally changed the game. Just, it just went somewhere to where I didn't even know it was going to go that far. But I did enjoy making it, and believe, when I played it, every time I played it, I smiled, and I smiled big.
So that track ended up coming out on a label from Detroit owned by DJ Godfather, who's probably best known for being one of the architects of Ghetto Tech.
Yes.
Came out on his Database label. But it came out as DJ Sluggo's tune and not yours.
Me and Sluggo was, we was real good friends. And even with Baby Come On, the Ice Cream Truck, and the other tracks, he was the type of person that would always try his best to look out for people. And Dance Mania had just collapsed. So we was aware that we wanted to push this to get it out on other labels, to give other labels an opportunity. And what happened was that after it came out, it did come out on a label where my name was announced on it. And it just had DJ Sluggo, the remixes. But what had happened was that we didn't know that it took off, because I was at work. And I didn't go to Detroit. I didn't go nowhere else. Spin, Rashad, Dion, think Funk went. Clint, and when word got back, it was, hey, Sluggo did, he's taking credit for your track that you did. But I already knew that, because Sluggo asked me to do, could he do a remix? Fine, no problem. I actually gave him my record so he could do it, chop his samples up. And I was like, yeah, I know Sluggo have a remix. And word got, but like, nah, it's not the remix that he's claiming. It's the one that you actually did. And when I saw the label and I saw the print, it was DJ Sluggo's remixes. But that wasn't the remix. It was the actual track. So he was able to put what he want, because I had no access to Godfather. And that's how they got, that's when it just went, no, I can't do this no more. Because Sluggo was not the only person that I had these problems with. I had problems with this with other people. That's why I left and became D-Dynamic. Once I became D-Dynamic, I saw the falling of a lot of people, because me being able to sit back on the tracks and not come out into their presence, they couldn't hear me no more. And when I come back, the tracks that I left them off with, they were still playing. And so I used to always come back with more heat, more heat, more heat. How you do it? I caught on to it. I say, you know what? It's a dirty game out here, but you have to learn from it. And I was able to hold my head up high and just say, you know what? I just had to learn from it. And what happened after that? And when I made the remix, the other one that you was asking me about, same sample. The same samples, nothing changed. I just reformatted the beat, and it took off as well.
So you put out this remix that you're referring to on Classics Volume 1 on Planet Mew some years later, I guess 2015? And this one is called 025203. What does that mean?
02 February. 5-2. I used to live on the street called Honorary, 5200. That's the fire too. 03, 2003.
Got you. I just bring this up because the streets are important. We'll be talking about some streets in a little bit. But let's hear this song that samples Godzilla. So as I seem to remember, that's 2003, around those times, as you mentioned, Dance Mania, which was like the premier Chicago ghetto house, street house label, was sort of at the close. Ghetto Tech was kind of going on in Detroit, but you weren't in Detroit, you're in Chicago. And a lot of people from the house scene in Chicago, like especially ghetto house, were like kind of trying to figure out what to do and what was next, because the label that they were all had a home at was no longer, and like, what's the next thing? So how did it get from stuff that sounds like this to the more broken stuff that we know today as Footwork?
Well, after that started going on, even though we still had, at this point in time, it was a young lady named Angelique. She decided one day she wants to do these dance troupe competitions. House-O-Matic had diminished, went somewhere else, and the up-and-coming footworkers started going into different dance groups, and we were able to have them come to like different park districts and have competitions against each other. And what was going on was I used to set up majority of the sound systems for these kids, and always was able to play new tracks, and we was putting out mixed tapes and mixed CDs at that point in time. But then it was this guy named Nick Parnell. We call him Nick's the Man. And he was just this phenomenal dancer that couldn't nobody beat him that was in the party, because he knew where he was going. But it was good people that was up there with him. But other DJs knew him through me, because I used to be in this crew called Gutter Thugs, and Gutter Thugs was like the top to come in to what the footwork crews had to go through us. But Nick and other DJs, like, we need to do something with this dude. They would make track after track after track to try to throw him off, and they just couldn't. He would just listen. So he said, you know what, man? He said, pay attention to what we always do. He said, they wait for the bass to drop. Then they start dancing. He said, we didn't burn them already. Well, what we mean burn them is basically if we know how to footwork, we could dance to anything. As long as there's a rhythm, there's a pattern to it, we would always start off dancing. We didn't care, as long as it has a rhythm to it. So I said, you know what? I got an idea. I said, I'm going to make this track, and it's not going to have no bass kicks, none. But it's going to be to the point to where you can flow. So it was this guy named Darion. Darion used to dance for Wolfpack, and he was our first victim. And when him and Nick started dancing, so I played the track. It's called Plat Solo. Matter of fact, I think it's, I would play it next. Plat Solo was to the point it just played. And it was off Space Odyssey 2001. Reason why I sampled that, because Ric Flair is one of my favorite wrestlers. So I had to use that against him. And when we played it, Nick, he did it. I'm talking about he covered the whole floor. But Darion was standing there, and he gave me this signal, like, when is the bass going to drop? We got him. I said, we pulled it off. We got him. After that, I started making the tracks, and I separated. It was no more 4-on-4s. Took it, just gapped it, but made it to the point to where you could see us doing it, and Rashad caught it. When Rashad caught it, then Click grabbed it. Then other people started catching it. Then it became like hereditary. Then after that, I took away all the claps and replaced the claps for snares. Snares and hi-hats. And that's when Footwork really got its, the sound really got its signature. This is Plat Solo.
So, I'm glad you mentioned DJ Rashad. May he rest in peace. When is the first time that you met him? Rashad is the founder of the Tech Life crew and the guy that a lot of people around the world first associated with the Footwork sound. Tell me about the first time you guys met.
I met Rashad at this place called the Elk Lodge, and it was an incident that took place that night that it happens every now and then. But after so many years, if a small commotion or a fight break out, we turn the music down and we seize the problem, make sure the police come in and conduct the business outside. So this one night, this guy, we had an issue. So the guy said, turn off the music. Okay, cool. Turn the music off. So I'm standing in front of the DJ booth, but right along to my left, there's a stage to where a crowd of people came up to see over my head to make sure nothing else was going on. And this one guy, Ronnie, was saying, well, turn the music up. This one guy comes past, he say, man, listen here. If you turn that music back on, me and you gonna have a problem. And this dude looked like he could knock a brick wall down. So I'm like, you know what? I'm fine. So a crowd of guys come up on the side of me, and this dude just stands there over my head. He looks at me, he said, hey man, can I get on? Who is somebody better get this dude, because he don't know, hey, we can't start this music back up. But that dude was Rashad. I didn't know who he was until the next 2 weeks later. And I started listening to him and I started hearing him, but not knowing he was already following me. He was inspired by the music that we do, but Rashad already had access to radio stations and producing tracks. So with that being said, a couple of months later, we moved out to the south suburbs at a spot called Cavallini's. Rashad was DJing when I walked in, and Rashad, he was wrecking the party, him and Spin, killing it. And he was like, well, get on. I want you to get on. So I played like four tracks before the music got turned off, man, to what, the end of the party. But he's telling everybody, like, man, this is the dude. At that point in time, I was not RP Boo. I was DJ Boo. And he say, if you can, next week, make sure you hit early. So when I came the next following week, that's when they got to see me. But Rashad, this is when I really first got to hear him. Those tracks that dude was playing was like, I knew where the tracks was coming from, the samples that he was using, but he just had his own little twist to him that could nobody touch but him. And I was like, this dude is just nasty. And anything that I did after that, even if it was a concept to what, he like, man, how you grab that? He a compliment. And from that point on, man, we just had one of the greatest bonds, just producing tracks and just feeding off each other. But yeah, I still remember that dude. Hey, man, can I get on? Nah.
I mean, Rashad and Spin were pretty young when you first met them, right?
Yes, they were still in high school.
They were like, what, 16, 17?
I think 16 to 17, yeah.
Because you were describing you're kind of like the big brother since yeah. You were a little bit older than they were.
As I would say that was like 97. That put me at 25 years old. Yeah, they was babies.
Can we show a video clip? I have a, this is from later. This is from 2010. Maybe it was filmed in 2009 of Tim and Barry from London went to Battlegrounds in Chicago. And it's a clip of RP DJing. And on the left, you'll see Rashad. And on the right, you'll see Spin. And I think Lightbulb from the Chicago dance crew, the era, is also in this clip dancing.
Yeah, that brings back memories.
What memories does that bring back for you?
Just being able to just see all us together and listen to that those blends, and that's the meat of footwork tracks being played when you in Chicago. It changes wherever you go, depending on who you are and what you do. But for me, it stays the same no matter where I go. But in Chicago, and like Spin say, you on beat. Only time when I'm spinning, it's the same thing. With the way footwork tracks are being made today and after Rashad started, and once Rashad started our network with other people, with drum and bass, it was more of mainstream sounds. And a lot of the guys came in after that started footworking. But when they get into those tracks, they bring them back home to the organic of it. When Spin says it all the time to those guys, oh, you got to dance on beat now. You got to dance to the source. Oh, that stuff you was doing before you heard this, now we really finna see if it really works. If you can't get in line with this, it's not that you can't, not saying that they can't dance. He's telling them, this is your format. Learn the format. Once you learn the format, then come out. But if you have to go backwards, don't just jump into it. Study it before you get in. And that's what it does.
What makes a good track that a dancer would want to footwork to?
Depend on the producer. It really does. I'm not the only one that does it. Traxman could do it every now and then. Clint can do it. Spin could do it. It's just what you have coming from your heart and what you want the track to deliver. My main approach is to be able to creep into your body, just the sounds, good subwoofers, the sound to work, even if you're not focusing on it, but being able to have some type of melody to where it catch a person's attention. If they can't dance, one of my greatest things I like to see people do is ball a face up. Like, what the is this? What is this I'm listening to? Not with the, I don't like it, but it caught their attention. That's what does it. That's just the start. And when people see the orchestration of the footworkers doing it, a lot of people learn and got into footwork just because of that. And just say, hey, what is this? What did y'all just bring me to? Man, I gotta learn how to do this. Is it hard? Once you learn it, you do. Footwork is the basics. After you learn the basics, it's not hard, but it does take some time. Well, once you master the basics, you can pretend it is you ride a skateboard and it fits in. You could do jumping jacks. You could do push-ups. It fits in. So that's why I tell people anybody could do it. Just don't rush it, but it will come. So that's what the music does.
It seems like you spend a lot of time with the samples and with them looping and figuring out ways where they can loop and say different things than they are, like maybe than the sample originally says. Like you seem to do a lot of telling stories through the samples that you use.
Yeah, that's the main goal for it, to tell the story. It's like me orchestrating a scene, but just let the music tell the story. So that's how it is. Like what I did, what you gonna do for Bob Legacy? It was the same thing. Telling the story, what you gonna do? I just took that. That was one of my favorite ones that I worked on. One of the last tracks I actually, when I first really, really got into it, is when I did this track called Under the Stack. Under the Stack was supposed to come out on Legacy, but we gave it to the Japan version. But that's when I really figured out how to work the R70 with a Tascam track board and channel the different samples without putting it inside the sampler itself. And it just came out so beautiful and loved. I'm like, oh, now I got it. But this was like 2009. So if I'm doing damage before then, I'm like, where is it going to go once I get what I really want? So it's still so much new stuff to come and being orchestrated. And I still have certain ideas with certain songs that I would like to use to help enhance that. And that's why I like, hey, if it works, it works. But I like to hear, like, I love to hear people talk about having a good time, listen to the music, and that makes me want to do more for them.
I mean, you've been making tracks since the early to mid 90s until now, and it wasn't, like you told me, it wasn't until you were 41 or 40 that you started traveling, DJing, playing this music. And you know, things happen, like this fallout with Sluggo, and you know, other people around you started touring or getting bigger. Like, what kept you going through all this time? Did you ever want to quit and just be like, I haven't, you know, release this by now, so I'm just gonna stop making music, or like, I got too busy with my work and my life, or what were you thinking like during these various points, or did that not bother you?
No, I worked, and me being able to work in at Speedway Timmin' the Oil, I worked there from 1995 to 2010, so that gave me a good 15 years. After I say 8 of those years was gone, I was like immune to work. That was it. My playtime was just making tracks. But to be able to see Spin and Rashad go out and travel, and Rashad loved the tracks, so I was able to still give him the tracks. I say, if I can't play them, at least I know they would get played. And that's what kept me going, and him actually giving me the reports back to say these tracks are, they really doing their things. And that's afterward, that's when I got the okay approach with the, hey, would you like to be a part of trying to put your music back out through this label called Planet Mood? I thought about what happened previous years, but I was like, this being a Rashad, I ain't worried about them. Why? Because they was one of the main ones who came back and gave me the report and had to help clear it up about I was the original person who made the 1147-99, and they always had my back. So Rashad was like, hey, man, what you want to do? I didn't think twice. I just went, and the rest is history.
And did Rashad also tell you that you were going to go on the road as a DJ?
He told me that he was always talking about me on the road. Then one day he came back from off this tour. I think it was in 2009. So he come back off the London tour, him and Spin. And me and I wasn't married at the point in time, but soon to be wife was talking. So I said, I want you to meet Spin and Rashad. And I haven't seen them in so many months. And it's like every time I see them, it was like it was a big smile on my face because I was proud of the success and them going around the world. So Rashad finally walks up. He say, hey, bro, it's time for you to go. What you mean? Say, they ready for you. Say, we've been telling them. Now it's time for you to go. I say, Rashad, you know I got this job and you know I can't go. I say, but if I do have a chance, you have to let me know 6 to 8 months in advance. He was like, oh, I know. He said, that's what I told him. So Rashad always had that brain. He already knew, hey, let him know a year in advance. He said, they waiting on you, bro. He said, you gotta go. Believe me, it's sucking my head. And that's when we had already did Bangs and Works, Volume 1 and Volume 2. So I gave him this track called Area 72. Nobody knew about Area 72. Nobody in the United States knew about this track. Rashad was the only person I gave it to. And I say, play this while you're out on tour. So he says, okay, bro, I'll play it. So he give me, sent me a text via email. Hey, bro, Area 72 doing pretty good. It's making a lot of noise. So I said, okay, cool, that's fine. So me not ever traveling across seas, he's over in London with Tim and Barry. And I'm outside walking downtown Chicago, and my phone rings. And the first call, this guy, Crossfire Watching Witness. Hey, bro, you got to give me that. Man, what's up with that Area 72? I just had to stop. I'm like, what? What you say? What's up with Area 72? I say, how you know about Area 72? Me saying about saying next was, the title is right. But how did they hear Area 72? Me not knowing about Don't Watch That TV and the time that it comes on here in the States, but the time you actually play. Soon as I said, I had to call you back. Before I can hang up the phone, another phone call comes in. Hey, Joe, it's Trax, man. I need that Area 72. How did you? What? He said Rashad played it. When? Just now, bro. I didn't see the tape until 2 days later, and I saw it, and he actually played it in its entirety. He stopped it. That was the first world premiere of any track that was footwork made from another country that was never played in its own states. And that's when I got the, hey, it's time for you an album. Can you drop us an album? And that's when I did Legacy. I'm like, you've been waiting for 4 years. Let's give him an album.
So what year was this that Area 72 dropped?
Area 72 would have been 2009 when I made it. But it just came out. It was just, here you go. And Area 72, the reason why I call it that is because I wanted something different and what it had to say. The year I was born, 1972. My style, my flow, my works, my sounds are from. My last name is Space. I'm coming to Earth. So I used everything that was inside of me. Hey, I'm the only, like, Lil Wayne had a picture on a double XL before. He standing on the moon. I looked at her, I said, I'm the only one that can stand on the moon. My last name is Space. I'm a real spaceman. So I incorporated all that. And when I used the sample from Philip Bailey, The Easy Lover, I was working at this home shopping center, Lowe's. And every night at a certain time, the song come on, and I'm just steady bobbing my head. I was like, you know what? I'm going to make this track. And it worked. I'm talking about it worked. It worked to the point to where, hey, we need this track. And it worked.
So did you always have it in your mind that you wanted your music to get out of Chicago? Or was for most of this time you were just like fixated on like what is going to make these dancers go or what is going to make people in Chicago go?
It was more about the inner city crowd, the people that's dancing, because when you don't have people around you to motivate you, it's like you trapped in the box. And that plays a big part with people, and I learned that through life. Once I became a person of inspiration to others, I said, this is what I want to do, inspire others to do it, because I seen too many people trapped in this box. Nobody never thought that this was going to happen to where I said, some people don't like social media. I can deal with it. The video cameras, the video blogs and all that, it helped. It's called understand the business. And when you understand it, it's it's a gateway to explore your creativity. And like they say, how do you distinguish a fire in a burning building? If you can, you close all the windows. No air gets in. So it puts it out. That's like how music is. If you want music to deteriorate, don't put it out. Every seep hole I get, if I can see, so I consider me making the tracks in a building where there's plenty of windows, but there's really no windows. It's just open air, so it gets out. It gets out, and whoever it gets out to, it grows with them because they know where the source comes from. It's just I want them to uplift it and take it as far as they can because I can't do it by myself.
And how do you feel about starting to tour as a DJ at the age of 40 when a lot of other people who are DJing are like, maybe I have to quit. I'm too tired, right, to traveling the world at 40. Every time I see you, you got a smile on your face. You look like you're having a great time.
I love it because this is something I never thought about. And a lot of people will never get the opportunity. And what inspired me to do more and more tours, when I went to my first abroad trip, I did Unsound in Poland. And the guys that represent from Polish Juke came to support me. And they had a conversation with me on Friday night? Yes, Friday night. So the guy says, hey, if we ever came to the United States and we went to BG's on 87th Street, would that be a problem for us to come in? Like, no, why? And I'm like, better yet, they'd probably ask you guys, can we go back with you? And the guy tell me, say, we were just wondering because we here in Poland, it's like some people can't get a passport. It's like you will never get a passport to get out, to go out of the country. He said, and that's something that we always want to do. We want to see Footwork for what it really is. That right there, I sat back and I went to my hotel room and I really thought about it. I say, I never thought that this was possible. I thought anybody could get a passport. And that right there made me think about people. I say, if they can't come see us, I'd be glad to keep hopping these flights to come see them. Give them what they don't see. And nobody knew what was going to happen the next night. So when I came back to Unsound to do my show, the guys were sitting front and center having a good time. But what I just turned the knob up at, I come from behind the turntables, and there was enough room. And it's hundreds of people just standing there, the lights going on and off. And I say, hey, nobody asked the question and saying, do I know how to footwork? And I gave them a show. So they asked, we saw footwork, and right there, I say, if they never see it again, here it go right here.
Well, on that note, maybe we can see a bit of your video.
Hey.
For Bangin' on King Drive.
Yes, roll it.
Can you explain what is the significance of Martin Luther King Drive and why you made this video and who the dancers are in it?
Well, with Bangin' on King Drive, it's a parade that goes on every year, the second week of August in Chicago, that celebrates back to school to get the kids something to be encouraging about, giving them a good time. Say, here, we're giving you something for the summer to enjoy, be motivated to go back to school and have a nice time. I've been doing the Bud Billy Kaday Parade for years. I first did it in my first dance group with Mega Move in like 92, 93. I got in House-O-Matic in late 93, and I did my first one with House-O-Matic in 94. So when we was doing it, the guy Ronnie Sloan says, why don't you try something? We're going to try something different. So the first great big part of history of Bangin' on King Drive that I started and it's still going on right now today, I was the first DJ to come down that parade spinning vinyl on two turntables. Nobody ever done it before. Right now today, even the radio stations got DJs. So that's one of my legacies. A second legacy with that parade is that I used to come in and set up a sound system after I stopped DJing for House-O-Matic, but I always had what they call that heat. We know you got something new, RP. Yeah. Play it. So as I play it, the kids go nuts. Hey, can we have that for our parade performance? Nah. I just do this test out the run. Just go. And so one of my best times at the parade, I was seen twice on national TV in one day. Nobody ever done that with two different groups. So when we did our fingers, bank press, and shoe prints with Bangin' on King Drive was done, that was actually my third parade track. But they just say three times a charm. So as Mike Paradine said, we want to do a video for Bangin' on King Drive. Better yet, we already got it done. No, you don't. No, you can't do that. Because it means a lot to the people in Chicago. I say, if you make a video explaining about Bangin' on King Drive, you know nothing about the culture. You don't know nothing about why this track was made. This track was made for purpose. It was made for the people in Chicago to have a good time at this one particular day. So he said, okay, we'll try to get a budget for you. So we did. We got the budget. Wheels put it together. And so it's this group called K-59. K-59 used to be a group we used to dance against in the House-O-Matic days, but they resurfaced. But the guy named is Marcus, the president of the group. What he wanted to do is start fresh with a whole new generation of kids. So he had started off with nothing but young ladies. And the work that he was doing with these young ladies and these young kids was just so inspirational to me. And when we had the opportunity to do this video, I invited to say, well, hey, Marcus, we got a video shoot for Bangin' on King Drive. He was already familiar with the track. And we told him we would like to ride on the float with you to get some footage. He was like, cool, no problem. My wife was like, how you gonna do the video? You need to do certain things to this video. It's the parade. You don't have to do nothing but just press record. That's it. It does its work. And it did. And when I say that video, it did its work. And after the video was made, every place I went to, people in different countries, no matter if they spoke English or not, they sung the song every time I played it. They sung it.
It is an extremely beautiful tribute to Chicago. So let's watch it. You know that video makes everybody want to go to Chicago, yeah, like right now.
Yeah, you know what? We got something planned for that, to make sure that when people do come to Chicago for those events, to what I would like to be a person to welcome them in and just really be there and to say, hey, welcome to my city, and enjoy the parade. The parade is a beautiful thing. And how I come up with the street names, that's because it's from the beginning to the end, from 39th to 51st, to being 55th. 39th is the entrance to what, hey, once you cross 39th Street, you come in through 35th, but that's where all the bands and the floats set up at. Once you cross 39th Street and Oakwood, you are in the parade. There is no, oh, no, we didn't. No, you are in the parade now. You get to like 40th Street, that's where the TV cameras at. Once you pass those TV cameras, now you got the world. First spot, 43rd. That's what, it's like every major street from there, you have to stop and basically give a performance for the people because they were. No, you gotta stop right here. You need to dance. So
So that's the streets that you're, the samples that you're saying are the names of the streets.
And when you get to 55th, that's where you go out the park at. But once you out the park, it's not like that no more, but it's what I come from. It's where they have seen the guys at on the basketball court. You got the basketball courts and you have the tennis courts. We used to go to either one, and it used to be squads waiting to, and that's where the battle used to be at. We used to be in that doing. I'm talking about people like, the parade that way. Nah, they that way. So that's how the name, that's how it comes, in the park we battle. So it all worked out. It all worked out.
So now that you're traveling the world a lot and going to places like Shanghai and Poland and stuff, is it harder? Your music is so rooted in Chicago and this dance history and the people that you're around. Like, how has it changed your music to be traveling all around the world? And is it hard to not be in Chicago as much because is Chicago essential to the music that you make?
Chicago's where I just sleep at when I'm at home. That's it. I don't think nothing else about it. The city is already embraced. Some people talk about, oh, we got to do this for our city. No, you don't. It was already done a long time ago. It's been done. You don't have to, there's nothing to prove in Chicago. Nothing. So when I go out, the only thing that changes is if I hear something that I learned or I heard from these different countries, or if it's a track that motivated me. So that's different. So it's growing outside of Chicago now. It's growing in other countries. No matter if people don't think so, oh, it's growing. It's growing. There's no limit to it no more. It's just do it. Do it. Be happy that you're doing it. And people that really love it, embrace it. The good part I like about it is being able to go to different countries that Spin and Rashad didn't touch, or places that they didn't go to, or people hearing, oh, we heard Spin and Rashad, now we get to hear you. But they knew that Spin and Rashad were like, wait till you hear RP. And the response is to, hey, man, what's this? Hey, Joe, how you do this? We ain't never heard nothing like this. We know some of the tracks, but what is this stuff coming from? Like, majority of it is like classics. And when I do play the new stuff, I announce it. And they be like, wait a minute. It constantly changes. That's me. I don't stay stuck in one. I could, my root is rhythm. But the change of it is how the sample going to go, or how I might say something, how I might throw it in, and how I might chop it up, make it just fly somewhere else. It'll pan left, pan right. And people are like, we're not used to that. Nah, get used to it. But when you do, by the time you catch up to it, I'm about another 20 to 30 years in front of you. So got to catch up. I'm loving it.
This is my last question, and then we'll open it up to the participants if they have questions for you. Cool. But what would you say is your main advice for young producers, either about making music or about being in the music business?
Put yourself in your music. Just see yourself and what you want to do. You got to have an audience. Imagine yourself in the audience, but knowing you back there. You know you want to have, I don't care if you physically don't know how to footwork, just long as you know how to, if you could jump up and down, that works. But make your music the way you see other people having a good time to it. But make them be able to be happy that they want to dance and evolve with it. But the people that's in your audience, they you. They are actually you. So just imagine yourself doing thousands of different things at one time, but you have control of it. And knowing that, hey, man, I want more. Focus on them. And one thing about this business that I learned, if it's two things, either you go do it as an individual or you go do it as a group. if you do it as a group, make sure the people that's with you, that's y'all, you all plan. You all got to have that same plan and that same vision. Somebody might be the front man, but that front man have to understand something else too. You can't do it all by yourself. And when you do it, don't be disappointed if somebody come knocking at that door. We would like to bring one of the people out of that group to another level. Not saying they going to another group, but they going solo. I have seen too many people break up because of that. But that's the game. That's the business. Be able to license yourself, incorporate yourself, be able to do your publishing, get your publishing situated, get all that done. And this is not a career. A lot of people think it's a career. Well, they think it's a career because of they see the TV cameras, the media going. If you got a good label, they give you're going to get the press. You will get press. But just because I know people that did have press, but didn't use it. And now they out here hustling. And they mad at the world because, but same opportunities I had. Answer your emails. Please answer your emails. Be on time. be polite. Because no matter what, until the day you own your own, you still have to work for somebody. There's nothing wrong with being a servant for somebody else. Because one day somebody's going to be a servant for you, and you have to be able to pass it on from generation to generation. And if you happen to be one of those people that, what we say, many are called, but few are chosen. Just because you chosen don't mean you're going to make it all the way. But if you do, you might be able to be the person that gets the calling. There's a difference between the calling and the career. The person who gets the calling is the person that a lot of stuff gravitates to them without them even knowing. But other people will see it. You have to be prepared to understand. If you open up something and there's going to be people that's follow behind it, there's going to be people that's going to be able to take it to another level and get paid way more money than you do. But they know, and the industry know, that you are the source. That means you did your job. If a person taking it out of hand and say, oh, this is my intent to be better than the person who I got it from, I guarantee you they will fail. So don't worry about it. Take it day by day. Don't rush it. If it took me 21 years to finally get to where I say I get to do what I really want to do, now the tour is taking off. The average person, you tell them, hey, it's going to take you 15 years. They ain't trying to hear that. What you mean? But when the person opens that door and it's open, me, Rashad, Traxman, Spin, we opened the door. And that door means to what we travel. When we open that door, all the other people have to do is just walk through it comfortably. But we still have people that don't know how to walk through it comfortably. And we just say, hey, our job is done. We opened the door. We know what we had to do. And I'm so glad that I was not the first person to do it. Believe me, I'm so glad. Because what happened to a lot of people after me was like they don't want to hear nobody else no more. And it's like, I said, man, thank you. That's why I say it's for other people to enjoy. That's why I open this door to say, go, just go, just go, please go. And always have a positive attitude. Don't be scared to put yourself in your music, and don't let nobody tell you that you can't do it. You can do it. It might take you some years, might take you some months, but once you get it, that overwhelm season will come in, but don't stop. don't stop until you can't do it no more, meaning you physically can't get up. And that's me. Yes, yes, yes. A-R-P-E-B-U.
We're not done yet.
Oh, no.
That was beautiful, though. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, you want to play them a little bit of this exclusive track while everybody gets their mind to the questions. So, you have a new EP coming out on November, in the end of November on Planet Mew, but we're actually going to hear something that you hear in Bangin' on King Drive at the end, but it's not out yet.
Yes.
What's it called?
This is Earth Battle Dance. Earth Battle Dance is not actually on the EP, but I'm going to let you hear what it sounds like after it clips off the video.
Okay, and after that, we'll do questions for the participants.
And that's Earth Battle Dance.
Exclusive. All right. Well, now it's time to open it up to some questions. So
please ask questions.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Would you be willing to give us a demonstration, brief lesson in footwork?
Well, let me see what I could do for you. I wasn't planning on doing anything. Let me see if I can find something around this joint. That I really like. Let me see. Yeah, I hums through a lot of stuff. Some Rashad. Hold on. Yes. Better yet. Yeah, I had to play some Clint. I like Clint. Yeah, I'll move around a little bit. Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Next. Oh, he's...
Thank you for that. I noticed a lot of... It seems like you get a lot of inspiration from, like, non-musical things in, like, the simple sense, like conversations or the everyday world. Do you find your inspiration from other genres as well, or do you find yourself getting inspiration more from like the non-conventional things, like as I said?
Here's the amazing part about what you just said, dealing with other genres.
Hold on.
Before I can even talk about what a genre was, when I was playing Ghetto House or Booty House, it was a lot of techno going around. I go record shopping, hearing these different types of dance songs, but not knowing what genre they was listed up under. And those songs was like, man, this is some good stuff. Other music always inspired me, always. I wasn't into, not too much of opera, but I ever used stuff from opera before. And at one point in time, actually in 2003 and four, I completely turned the radio off for good. And that's what a lot of my creative work really came about, because that's where the conversations come in at. And I was like, it's the best of both worlds. I look for something on the radio that would be inspirational other than Michael Jackson, but it was just start dying.
So have you turned, like, you're not listening to the radio at
all? No, I don't listen to the radio at all. Ben turned it off.
But you take walks a lot when you go to different cities for gigs. I was wondering if you get a lot of ideas in that process.
That I'm searching. That's why I walk. I'm searching. Because the ideas could come from anywhere. Hearing sirens, people laughing, kids playing different sounds. I just take it from that. Or like the song that's on the EP called What Am I? I was in Shanghai, China, and heard a rap sample with this sample in it. I'm like, you know what? I have to use that. So it's just, my ears is just open. They never close. I'm talking about never close. So you have to take advantage of your senses. Use your senses, what you see, what you hear, what you touch, what you can smell. I don't care what it is. Use your senses. You can make music by your senses because it goes with you. It's a part of you.
Hello. I'd just like to say that, ask you actually if you've seen anything similar to Footwork around the world, and if you've been to Brazil or Rio de Janeiro, where we have like a really amazing kind of...
Well, yeah. I haven't been there yet, but I know the dance culture there is very serious, and I love it. I'll talk about it, I love it. I even seen people from South Africa actually comes and do it, and I was just like, it's amazing. Footwork to me, the way people try to explain it, it's nothing new to me. I was just, it just changed this shift in its formatality of what it looks like. I look at old Gregory Hines videos, and I say, you know what? These dudes was footworking for years. The only difference between them and footworking now is the shoes. That's it. And they was more energetic back then. So that's why I tell these guys, just be creative in what you do. Because tap dancing, Brazilian dances, the people over in Lisbon, oh my God. And it's just love to see these people dance. And it's rhythmic. So it was here before we got here. That's why I tell people, stop focusing on the money issue. Enjoy what you do. If you want to do it for the money, that's you. But these different cultural dances, I love it. I just love to see it because that is nothing new. It's from the heart. That is not nothing that was created to say, hey, look at me. No, these are people enjoying themselves and sharing their lives with people through how they dance. And I understand it very well.
I was, while listening to your music, you get this feeling that's very, like, complex, rhythm-heavy, but it's still, like, very interesting and approachable. Like, I want to know what your approach is, like, when you, like, sit to think about rhythms and create while producing and stuff.
No, I don't think about the rhythm. It comes out naturally. That's something off my first track I ever made. It was just there. And it took me a while to understand it, but it was identified through other people. And them taking these tracks or telling me this is something different, it's the same thing for me. It's like almost like my pop saying, you might don't know how to read music, but it's in you. Some people have that gift. Then you can still go back and study it and really get a format of it. But it comes natural for some people. I know how I want my some bass patterns to go, but it's certain things within that gap that the sample could become the rhythm and just shape it up. And I have had tracks that was done like that before, and I'll say, hey, if the sample is being the rhythm, I ain't got to put nothing else behind it. I just let it ride. And I had that confidence, and it works.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hey, obviously footwork music takes a lot of its inspiration from other genres and anything, basically. But I just wanted to ask, how do you feel about other genres taking elements of footwork and turning it into something completely new, maybe at faster tempos or slower tempos?
A lot of people get footwork confused with, it's not about the tempo. You could play... For what the footwork sound, it was created off of helping out like the juke booty house by experimenting sped up. Then after Rashad left and went overseas, Rashad was always the type of person that loved to network with other people. So that's how the other some drivers started coming behind him. And I wouldn't say bite off it, but being able to say embrace it. But what everybody failed to realize, you have to come back to Chicago. And the reason why it's not in Chicago right now, because I'm traveling. Because I have had some bad ordeals go down with promotionals and promoters and people trying to do parties that I will never let happen again. So until I set things back up, but you all will be able to see it. It's something about having that one spot in Chicago to where you could just walk in, and I guarantee you, you will never hear nothing ever like it again unless you come back. But what it would do, it would enhance you to go out and motivate at whatever genre you are already in. I guarantee you don't have to come out of footwork to make it happen. You'll just be able to say, well, hey, it drives you to do more and better for what you do. And I guarantee you that when you play whatever genre that you was in that's not footwork, I guarantee you that track is going to change. And it's going to change to where, like, it might still be in that genre where you at, but I guarantee somebody will be like, something sparked this dude. And that's what footwork music does. It sparks. And that's our mission, just to spark you to become better.
Does it bother you if people who are not from Chicago and not from the culture of footwork incorporate footwork stuff in their music?
No. It's the same, and it has to grow. It has to grow. It's so much alive. It is so alive, and that's what they can't take away from it. It's alive. And we are actually walking around being able to tell people and talk about it. It's so alive to the point to where there will never be another one behind it like it. It's either going to grow or it's not going to diminish. But like I tell people about sounds, period. Sounds, you could stop dancing, but the sounds will always be here. And what I take about with my music, and I learned by reading books and being spiritual, because I do believe in a higher power, a spiritual person. When you walk outside the door and the wind is blowing, you hear the wind blowing off the leaves. You hear the water splashing, because it's life deals with air and wind. Whatever you hear and it's silence, that's the earth playing back music, period. That's music. That was here before that came. So that's music. You incorporate and you put yourself there. So that's why I tell people, you can't tell me, this genre better than that genre, this genre better than that genre. Nah, because at the end of the day, as long as you take what you are blessed with every day to wake up and you got your hearing, you take that and you enjoy life and incorporate it in everything that you do. Don't be afraid to stand up and be a spiritual being and let people know, hey, they're going to ask you, why you like that? Because I'm spiritual. You just don't dump it on them and saying, hey, I'm a spiritual being. And they didn't ask you. See, it's the opposite. A person see what you do good and they question you. They always going to question your good. You know by just hearing how they ask the question, and you just lay it on them. Hey, I'm just a happy person. I enjoy life. And just pay attention to what's around you. You could put it in how you talk, how you fix your food, how you raise your families, how you play your music, how you make your music, and to how you play your instruments. It's all incorporated. So that's life.
Really nice to meet you, Bert. Thank you for the lecture. I'm curious to know, what do you think about the evolution of the dance music in general and house music? Yeah. And who are the artists now that make you feel like back in the days?
Good one. Well, to me, it's well, as we come along with this music, when I did sneak into the radios, the only people that really made me just sit back and just say, man, this is some beautiful music, is when I first heard it's two different artists. When 808 States did Pacific State, that was like, when I first heard somebody play that in a mix, I was like, what is this? This is not no Chicago house. This is something different. I could tell that it was like from overseas somewhere, and it was just so refreshing. And it took me like about 4 to 5 years to find out what the name of that track was. But when I found out, that was what I drove to. A lot of people to know that I hid behind closed doors listening to that track. And I didn't know how to express myself to the public about those type of songs I like. Then when Def Punk came out, I was like, where these dudes come from? And it was the enjoyment of it and just listen to it. But what comfort me with music today is to go back and see my father and talk to him. That's my source right there. Even before he played bass for Prince for like 6 years, even before that, just him and his conversation telling me about music and how he enjoyed music, I just really just love to hear him talk. I try to dib and dab into what's happening today in the music worldwide. As long as it's dance music, something you could mix this off of, not too much of going EDM nuts. I listen. I like to hear other DJs play on my day off, but when I'm at home in Chicago, it's this one guy. His name was DJ Emmanuel Pippin. He was one of the guys that fought to keep Chicago house music alive. And he took the bashings, the people criticizing him, the people telling him he won't go do nothing, but he fought for years. And right now today, he's one of the main people to go see in Chicago on a Sunday night, playing like disco, house, Chicago house, and just playing it like nobody else could play. So other than that, I still find myself going back. But if it's something that could catch my ears, if I'm due to I'm open, I would cling on to it. But so far, nothing has changed within the past like 5 years.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Go ahead.
Hey, thanks for the lecture and very much look forward to a set tonight.
Thank you.
Like obviously drum machines are like playing a very important role in your music and in dance music in general. I'm just wondering how do you feel about like the drum machines or the gear you have, how they restrict or help you in your creativity?
Well, the difference is like before the MPC Studio came out and the Cakewalks and the Ableton, we was limited. And with that being said, I seen how the software has made things so open. But I still haven't changed over to that format until last year. I was just real good at what I use, even though I was limited. But I understand it was just Jammy Gerald told me, say, bro, whatever you doing, you don't have that much sample time. But you killing the game with just that little bit of sample time. Nobody could do what you did. He said, you got a mark. And what you do, whatever you do to keep that mark going, keep it. And he made me feel to where I was not limited with analogs and with the drum machines. But then I learned with the drum machines that the sounds still are warm. They still pack that punch that everybody really wants inside the transfer from the MP3 files load up, and then you can sequence the sounds or do whatever, it loses that warmth. So I still stick with it because that's all I had in front of me until, I say, 2014, before I got the MPC studio. I stayed with the same thing. I was like, let me try something else different. So with this new EP, the R70 is not even on it at all. Everything on that new EP is all MPC studio. But just like I still had that R70, oh, I still go back to it because that R70 packs the most nastiest punch ever. And those tracks that you was hearing, majority of them are R70. And that's why that the bass and the, anything out of the bottom of that R70 is the best. That was the last best drum machine that ever came out. So I thank Roland for that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Cool. Well, I think we're good. Everybody give it up for our people.
Thank you. Thank you.